وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، وإن التفسير of سورة الأعلى، and we took up to the verse of Allah سبحانه وتعالى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى. And we spoke about that particular verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says after that, سَيَذَّكَّرُ مَنْ يَخْشَى. He who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be reminded. This ayah, سَيَذَّكَّرُ مَنْ يَخْشَى, it's clarifying that when the reminder is given, and the people are reminded, the people who are going to benefit from it are the first party of people. And the second group of people are those who will not benefit from the reminder. And Allah mentioned the fariqul awwal, the first type of people. He said, سَيَذَّكَّرُ مَنْ يَخْشَى, the people who will take this reminder, and will benefit from it, are those who have khashya, who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This reminder will settle in their hearts and be a reminder to the people who are what? الَّذِي يَخَافُ اللَّهُ, the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what does he fear Allah based on? عَلَى عِلْمٍ, based upon knowledge. He has knowledge of Allah, and so that knowledge of Allah has resulted, for him to be what? To be a person who whenever reminder is given him, he'll take it on board. وَلِذَلِكَ, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Qur'an, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَى, the people who fear Allah are only the scholars. Allah uses what word? إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ. وَلِذَلِكَ, the word khashya and the word khawf are two different things. Khashya and khawf are two different things. People always translate them both to be fear. Khashya means it is to fear Allah with veneration. It is khawfu ma'a ta'zim. It's fear with veneration. You're glorifying him whilst you're scared of him. Like in khawf, it means that you're scared of something. It doesn't necessarily mean that you venerate the thing. When can a person attain veneration? Fear, people can attain that, that's nothing. Like when does veneration and glorification come? When the person knows this thing very well. When a person knows something very well, their fear will be ma'at ta'zim. It will be veneration and glorifying. And so that's why the reminder increases you in knowledge, and that knowledge results to what? Fear. And it will benefit that person. وَلِذَلِكَ, that's why when you see the believers, the righteous ones, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us that when they are reminded of Allah and they are told of Allah, they are ones who take it on board and they don't dismiss that reminder. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يُعْجِبُكَ قَوْلُهُ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيُشْهِدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا فِي قَلْبِهِ وَهُوَ أَلَدُّ الْخِصَامِ وَإِذَا تَوَلَّى سَعَى فِي الْأَرْضِ لِيُفْسِدَ فِيهَا وَيُهْلِكَ الْحَرْثَ وَالنَّسْلَ وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَسَادَ وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ اتَّقِ اللَّهَ أخذته العزة بالإثم فحسبه جهنم ولبئس المهاد. Some people, when you say to them, يا أخي, fear Allah, أخذته العزة بالإثم, he becomes arrogant. Who do you think you are telling me to fear Allah? You fear Allah. Who made you a person to look over me? That's what he says. And he dismisses the reminder that was given to him. Like in the person who has real knowledge of Allah, a person who fears Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that reminder, what will he do for him? It will benefit him. And what would he do? He would take it on board. And brothers, I want you to remember this. It's very important that you remember this, which is a person who takes on reminder and the reminder benefits him, is a person who admits and believes that he's incomplete. He knows he's deficient. So when somebody comes up to you and tells you this is your weakness, you're going to take it on board because you knew you were deficient. But when the person rejects the reminder and dismisses the reminder, there's a preconceived notion. There's this thought in his mind which is that he's complete. How dare you tell me I'm wrong? How dare you tell me I'm wrong? Because he believed he was complete. There's nothing wrong with him. So that's what happens. And this characteristics of being complete is for who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then when somebody reminds you of Allah and tells you to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then take it on board and be one who benefits from that reminder. We talked about that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the ayah, وَإِذْ قَالَتْ أُمَّةٌ, when a group of people said, لِمَ تَعِذُونَ قَوْمًا إِلَّهُ مُهْلِكُهُمْ, why are you going to give a reminder to a people? Allah is going to destroy them. أَوْ مُعَذِّبُهُمْ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to punish them a severe punishment. قَالُوا مَعْذِرَةً إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ. The first reason why we're going to do that is that we want to not be punished the day of judgment and not conveying this message, number one. وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. And we're also doing it so that these people who we're giving the reminder to, they may come to their senses and they may fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then every reminder that's given is for three reasons. مَعَذِرَةً إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ. So this responsibility is uplifted from your shoulder. Number two is that وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ, and that the person that you're reminding may benefit from that reminder. And the third reason is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he told us رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ, that there's no proof for this person the day of judgment that you're giving the reminder for. He's without any proofs. Two of those things will always happen. Will it not happen? Two will always happen. You will get the reward for the calling that you're doing. And you will not be questioned the day of judgment in why you didn't convey this message. One, that's a benefit you're going to get, regardless of whether the person takes it or not. Number two, and you're going to remove a proof from this individual. This person is going to be without no proof. The third one is what may happen and may not happen. That the individual benefits from the reminder. Naam. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, وَيَتَجَنَّبُهَا الْأَشْقَى, and the wretched ones, the criminals and the wretched ones will avoid this reminder. Allah tells us, وَيَتَجَنَّبُهَا, the wretched ones will avoid it. This dhamir, which is وَيَتَجَنَّبُهَا, this dhamir, which is ha, that ha, where does it go back to? It goes back to فَذَكِّرْ, it goes back to. It goes to the reminder. They're going to avoid the reminder. The wretched individuals, they would avoid the reminder. When they're reminded of Allah, they would push it to the side. They would what? They would push it to the side. And this is the fariq al-thani, the second type of people when it comes to the reminder. The first type of what? They were the ones Allah said, سَيَذَّكَّرُ مَنْ يَخْشَى. The wretched ones, lakin, what are they going to do? They are going to avoid it. They're going to dismiss it. They're going to not listen to it. And they're not going to take it on board. فَلَا يَقَعُ فِي قَلْبِهِمْ, it will not fall, the reminder will not come to their minds. These individuals, they have أَعْيُنٌ, they have eyes but they can't see, ears but they can't hear. And they have a heart, they can't ponder and they can't take the reminder that's been given to them. These are the wretched ones. The ones who have شَدِيدُ الشَّقْوَى, severe destruction and the hellfire is their final abode. So he won't take that reminder on board. وَيَتَجَنَّبُهَا الْأَشْقَى الَّذِي يَصْلَ النَّارَ الْكُبَرَى. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says the word أَشْقَى. Grammatically, أَشْقَى comes in the form of أَفْعَلْ. اسم تفضيل ليس على بابي. Grammatically, this أَشْقَى is not in accordance to its normal usage. اسم تفضيل ليس على بابي, the grammarians say. And we're going to see it later inshaAllah ta'ala, which is وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. And أَبْقَى is اسم تفضيل ليس على بابه, which is why what does it mean اسم تفضيل ليس على بابه. Some of the mufassirin, they said وَيَتَجَنَّبُهَا الْأَشْقَى, if we take أَشْقَى as اسم تفضيل أَفْعَل and it according to the way it should be, then that means it's only talking about the disbelievers because they are the ones who are أَشْقَى. The superlative referring to them, they're the worst, the most wretched. Are we all together? Some scholars who took the second qawl, they said no, ashqa is ismu tafdil laysa ala babi, so the believers also fall under it. There are some believers who are also wretched, but they're not ashqa, they're shaqi, not ashqa, shaqi. And the usage of ashqa here is ismu tafdil laysa ala babi, so the believers, they can also fall under this, that there are amongst the believers those who would avoid the reminder and dismiss it and not take it on board. So now Allah tells us the ashqa, who are they? Allah tells us الَّذِي يَصْلَى النَّارَ الْكُبَرَى. They're the ones who will burn in what? The greatest fire. Here Allah tells us النَّارَ الْكُبَرَى. This fire, ya ikhwa, that they're going to burn in, that they're going to be thrown into, is a nar. الْكُبْرَى, the greatest fire. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us in the hadith al-Imam al-Tirmidhi, narrated in his Sunan, narukum hadihi, the fire that we use today, ya ikhwa, the fire that we use in this world and that we are cooking with, the volcanoes that we see today. I remember a couple of years back, one of the volcanoes erupted, and so then aeroplanes were refusing to go over that particular area. Planes were not allowed to go because of the heat and the worry that, and the fear that they had. The Prophet told us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fire that he brought to this world that we're using, including the volcano, narukum hadihi juz'un min sab'ina juz'an min nari jahannam. This fire that we're using is one portion of 70 portions of the fire of the hellfire. 69 times jahannam is more hotter than it. 70 minus 1, sah? 69 times Jahannam is more than it. I came across a hadith al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, and Imam Malik narrated in his Muwatta, and the wording that I'm going to narrate is the wording of Imam Malik in his Muwatta. And I came across al-Imam Hafidh ibn Kathir. He authenticates it in Suratul Qari'ah. He authenticates it there, al-Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, which is that the Prophet said, هذه النار ضريب بها البحر سبع مرات. This fire that we're using today, it was run through the ocean 7 times. It was run through the ocean 7 times. To what? To reduce its heat. ولولا ذلك من تفع به أحد. And if Allah did not do that, nobody would benefit from the fire. It's too hot. So the heat had to be reduced. Jahannam's heat is excessive. Jahannam's heat is so hot that the hellfire had to be run through the ocean 7 times in order for it to be reduced, and so we can benefit from it. So this is not a place, ya ikhwa, that a person's body can take, and the heat we cannot tolerate. So let's be from those who take these reminders on board and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qalban wa qaliban, externally and internally. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. He has certainly succeeded. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ, he has certainly succeeded. The word قَدْ is توكيد, emphasis. So it means certainly. أَفْلَحَ, succession, I mean succeeding, he has received success. Who? مَنْ تَزَكَّى, the individual who purifies himself. The person who purifies himself has truly attained success. Has truly what? Has truly attained success. Yeah? I left an ayah, yeah? Ha. ثُمَّ لَا يَمُوتُ. الَّذِي يَصْلَى النَّارَ الْكُبْرَى ثُمَّ, and after that, لَا يَمُوتُ فِيهَا, they will not die in it. In what? They're not going to die in the hellfire. وَلَا يَحْيَى, and they're not going to live in it. What does it mean that they're not going to live and they're not going to die? What it means is that death is not going to come to them, because if death comes, they're going to relax. يَتَجَرَّعُهُ وَلَا يَكَادُ يُسِيغُهُ وَيَأْتِيهِ الْمَوْتُ مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ وَمَا هُوَ بِمَيِّتٍ. All of the reasons for death is there. Every reason for him to die is there. The pain, the struggle, and everything he's going through. On a normal day in the world, he would have died from this. يَتَجَرَّعُهُ وَلَا يَكَادُ يُسِيغُهُ. But the thing that's happening to him cannot really take him to death. وَيَأْتِيهِ الْمَوْتُ مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ. Death is coming to him from every angle. But death has been killed. The angel of death, who is meant to kill him, has been killed. So how is he going to die? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, he would want that day to die. And you say, وَنَادَوْ يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكُ قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. Malik, call unto Allah. Tell him, لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكُ. Let Allah bring us to an end. A day where the person will wish what? The person will wish that they died and that they they want to die, they don't want to live because of the pain and the agony in which they are enduring from the hellfire. In another ayah, Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَهُمْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَا لَا يُقْضَى عَلَيْهِ فَيَمُوتُ وَلَا يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُم مِّنْ عَذَابِ رَبِّهَا كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي كُلَّ كَفُورٍ. Allah tells وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَهُمْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَ, that the disbelievers, for them is نَارُ جَهَنَّمَا لَا يُقْضَى عَلَيْهِمْ فَيَمُوتُ. They are not going to be given death so they can come to an end. وَلَا يُخَفَّفُ, and also the hellfire will not be reduced for them. They're not going to, reduction is not going to take place. And they're not going to die. And then Allah tells us in that ayah, كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي كُلَّ كَفُورٍ. This is the way we reward and punish every individual who disbelieves in me. So that day, what's going to happen to them? ثُمَّ لَا يَمُوتُ. They're not going to die. ثُمَّ لَا يَمُوتُ. They will not die فيها in the hellfire. وَلَا يَحْيَا, and they're not going to live. There's no life and there's no death. It's in between it. Pain and agony is what's made for them. That is what's made for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the inhabitants of Jannah and protect us from this destruction and this punishment. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ. He has received and has certainly succeeded. Who? مَنْ تَزَكَى. The one who purifies himself. The one who tazkiyah of himself is an individual who is going to find what? He's going to find success. The one who does tazkiyah of himself, who purifies himself, is going to find success, brothers. Now the question is, what is the tazkiyah that we need to come with? Brothers, pay attention to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brought what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who did he bring? He brought Nabiullah Muhammad to this world. Did he not? Did he not bring Nabiullah Muhammad? What is it that Nabiullah Muhammad came to do? هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابُ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُّبِينٍ. Nabiullah Muhammad's mission in this world was to do two things. What was it, the two things that he came to do? Tazkiyah wa yu'allimuhum al-kitab wal hikmah. It was to do tazkiyah of the people, and we're going to come to what that means, and also wa yu'allimu, it is to educate the people. The kitab, yu'allimuhum al-kitab, is the Quran, wal hikmah is the sunnah, to teach that both of those to them. Are we all together, brothers? This is what Nabiullah Muhammad came to do. And this was a dua. Who made it? Who made this dua that Allah sends a prophet that does these two characteristics? Nabiullah Ibrahim. رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. Oh Allah, send amongst them and send down on them a prophet that gives them tazkiyah and that gives them knowledge. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, Ibn al-Qayyim said, that the tazkiyah and the knowledge, what does it mean? He said that the minimum of tazkiyah and the minimum of knowledge that a person needs for knowledge is certainty. He has to have certainty. Anything that gives him certainty about his religion, that's the minimum he needs. Are we all together? And the tazkiyah, the minimum that a person needs, he said, it's sabr, patience. Are we all together? The minimum is what? Sabr. لأن الصبر مطية لا يضل راكبها. Patience is what? Patience is a riding beast that if a person takes, he will never lose out. And there's two cars that are blocking. One is a Nissan, and the other one is a Nissan, right? Well, one is Toyota, one is a Nissan. One is W682PGC GL55HUO. If your car is blocking someone, please move your car. Barakallahu feek. So the minimum of tazkiyah is what, brothers? Patience. And what is the minimum of knowledge? Certainty. If we have patience and certainty, what do we gain? بِالصَّبْرِ وَالْيَقِينِ تُنَالُ الْإِمَامَةَ فِي الدِّينِ. With patience and certainty, you will reach leadership. Didn't Allah say in the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَدْعُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. When they attain patience and certainty, Allah made them leaders. Then we don't have to come with all of knowledge as Muslims to become leaders of this world. And we don't have to come with all types of tazkiyah. We just have to come with what? Al-yaqeen and sabr. What will we be? Afaq al-ard, mashariq al-ard wa magharibiha. The whole universe, the whole world Allah will give to us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all that's not been with us. So success is for who? The one who does tazkiyah of his nafs. He purifies his nafs. What is it that he purifies from himself, brothers? Al-shirk wal-bid'at wal-ma'asi. He purifies from himself shirk. He purifies from himself what? Innovation. He purifies from himself sins. What does he cultivate himself on? The opposite. What is it that he cultivates himself upon? At-tawheed wa sunnah wa ta'ah. Then Allah says, وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. And success has been attained. And he's also attained success. The one who what? ذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ. And mentions the name of his Lord. فَصَلَّى. And he prays. What does it actually mean? وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ. The Mufassirin have three aqwal, three views of what's meant by وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ. He mentions his Lord. The first qawl is a وَحَّدَ اللَّهَ. He singles Allah in ibadah. And he doesn't associate partners with Allah. Number two is what? دَعَاهُ. He calls on to his Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and supplicates to Allah. The third one is خَافَهُ. He fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he said, وَالصَّوَابُ. The view that's correct is leaving it unrestrictedly. Because it encompasses all of that. All of that are in it. So this ikhtilaf is called ikhtilaf al-tanawu', ikhtilaf in the wording. But the meaning is all the same. It means all of that. فَصَلَّى means what? And he prays. There's four aqwal of what the scholars said. فَصَلَّى, he prays. One is, أي صلى صلوات الخمس. He prays his five daily prayers. The second qawl is, أي صلى صلوات التطوع. He prays the voluntary prayers. The third qawl is, صلى صلاة العيدين وهذا فيه نظر. The third view says that he prays the salatu al-eidain. And this one, there's a look to it. Why? Because the surah is makkiyah and salatu al-eidain was not legislated in what? In Mecca. So he can't mean that. The fourth qawl is that the salah here means a da'a. He called unto his Lord. Because the word salah, what does it mean? What does the word salah linguistically mean? It means ad-du'a. So those are the four aqwal. One of them is very weak. Even the tazkiyah, the scholars, they have three aqwal in it as well. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَى. The first qawl is مَنْ كَانَ عَمَلُهُ زَاكِيًا. Anyone whose actions are purified. This qawl is attributed to Abdullah ibn Abbas. It's also attributed to Ali ibn Abi Talha and Qatada and others. Also, Hassan al-Basriyu. Also, Ikrimah. The second qawl is, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَى means, أي مَنْ أَدَّى زَكَاةَ مَالِهِ. The one who pays zakat of his money has found success. Who gives the money Allah has given him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in zakah. This qawl is attributed to Abi al-Ahwas, Qatada and others. The third one is مَنْ أَدَّى زَكَاةَ الْفِطْرِ is referring to what? زَكَاةُ الْفِطْرِ. This qawl is attributed to أَبِي عَالِيَةَ الرَّيَاحِ. And the ظاهر, what's apparent from the verse is العموم, to leave the verse general. So all of those meanings come under it. And that's what Ibn Jarir al-Tabari also said. He said وَالصَّوَابُ مِنَ الْقَوْلِ فِي ذَلِكَ أَنْ يُقَالَ وذكر الله فوحد ودعا إليه ورغب لأن كل ذلك من ذكر الله ولم يخصص الله تعالى من ذكره نوعا من دون نوع. Allah didn't restrict it to a particular type, so it's unrestricted. Then Allah تبارك وتعالى He says بل rather but تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا, you prefer the worldly life. There's another qira'ah which is بَلْ يُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا as a ya. بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ, rather you give preference and you choose the حَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا, the life of this world. وَلِذَلِكَ the scholars, they say the word dunya comes from the word dunu. What does dunu mean? Something that's low. The word dunya means, from the Arabic language, it comes from the word dunu. Something that's very what? That's very low. Why is it low? Because the Prophet said, "Ad-dunya mal'oonun, mal'oonu ma fiha illa dhikrullah wa ma walaha alimun aw muta'allim." That this world is cursed. And everything in it is cursed except a scholar and a person who's what? A learned person and a person who's learning. Those are the only exception. Everything else is cursed. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, to show you how low this dunya is, لو كانت الدنيا تعدل عند الله جناح بعوضة ما سقى منها كافر شربة ماء. If this world was equal to the wing of a mosquito, Allah would not have let a disbeliever drink water from it. But because it's less than even a wing of a mosquito, that's why Allah gave this dunya to the disbeliever as well. And we know Allah said in the Quran, وَلَوْلَا أَن يَكُونَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً رجعنا لمن يكفر بالرحمن لبيوتهم سقفا من فضة ومعارج عليها يظهرون ولبيوتهم أبوابا وسررا عليها يتكئون وزخرفا وإن كل ذلك لما متاع الحياة الدنيا والآخرة عند ربك للمتقين. The dunya, because it's nothing, Allah allowed the disbeliever to have children in it. Allah gave him money. Allah is allowing him to enjoy himself because the dunya means nothing to Allah. And that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions, they tried to make the dunya. The Prophet said to them alayhi salatu wasalam, "Ma li wa lid-dunya illa karakib istadalla tahta shajara faraha wa tarakaha." What is this dunya to me? It is only to me a person who came under a shade just so he can stay under this shade for a little bit until the sun moves away and he can leave at a time when the sun is not too hot. This is what the dunya is for me. The dunya means nothing to me. And the Prophet nurtured his companions not to see this dunya as to be something. That's why he said to the noble companion Abdullah ibn Umar, he said to him, "Kun fi dunya ka'annaka gharibun aw 'abiru sabil." Be in this world like you are a what? A stranger or a person who's crossing a road. Neither of those two take long. You cross the road fast when you're crossing a road, or when you're a traveler. Okay, what do, brothers? You know, if you go to a hotel and you're going to stay there, you're a transit and you're going to stay there for one night or less 7, 8, 9 hours, you're a transit in that place, and they gave you a hotel for whatever reason they did, and they allowed you to, are you going to take out everything that's in your bag? Are you going to hang them all in the closet and in the wardrobe? Are you going to put everything into the desks? Or you're going to keep your stuff inside your bag? What are you going to do? You're going to be prepared and packed. Because you know any minute you're going to have to leave. Sah? Hakada. Like that, a believer in this is like this in his dunya. He's like that in his dunya. He's a stranger. He knows the reason why he's in this dunya is for what? He's here for this dunya so he can actually accumulate actions. That's what he's here for. But the people, what do they like? كلا بل تحبون العاجلة وتذرون الآخرة. What do the people like? The people like this hasty life. This is what they give their heart to. But the hereafter, when it comes, what happens to them? There's nothing that they accumulated. They gave their whole life to what? ولذلك أبو حازم, when the man said to him, "Why is it? Why is it نحب الدنيا ونكره الموت?" Why is it that we love this dunya and we dislike death? And he said something very powerful. He said, لِأَنَّكُمْ عَمَّرْتُمْ دُنْيَاكُمْ. Because you've exerted all your efforts into this dunya. وَخَرَّبْتُمْ آخِرَتَكُمْ. And you destroyed your hereafter. You never worked for it. So you don't like to transit from a place where you've put your hard work and effort in a place that you've destroyed and you've put no hard work towards. صح. That's why بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. We give preference, we love, we admire, what? We love this dunya. Like in Allah says, وَالْآخِرَةِ, the hereafter, is what? خَيْرٌ, is best. وَأَبْقَى, is also what? It's remaining. Two characteristics Allah told us that the akhir is better. One is khair, it's better. وَأَبْقَى, it remains, it will forever be. If you're given good in the hereafter, then that's forever. And this is a characteristic that should get a person's attention and really want him make him want the hereafter. Because what did Iblis try to use against Adam? He said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى الشَّجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكٍ لَا يَبْلَى. Should I not tell you the tree of what? The tree of eternity. To live forever, isn't that a characteristic we like? We love it. Then that's the hereafter. This dunya, whether you like it or not, you're going to die, you're going to taste the bitterness of death. Every one of us. If you see a person die before you, it's a matter of days, maybe months, maybe years, before you take that path. And you will be forgotten just like that person got forgotten. Life will move on. People will do their things. Your wife will carry on with her life. Your children are going to move on. And nothing's going to stop. Nothing's going to come. Nothing's going to pause. That's it. You're on the other side. Either you're going to be from the inhabitants of Jannah or you're going to be from those who are thrown into the hellfire. وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ. آخِرَةُ is. وَلِذَلِكَ وَاللَّهِ, when you look at the Salaf, one thing you always find, which is what? Their hearts are actually hanging on the hereafter. Every time, any statement they say, anything they do, anything that they place, it's always Akhirah. What? It's always the Akhirah. That's all their vision was. Everything here just was, they can't see around them what's happening. All their eyes are attached to is Akhirah. وَلِذَلِكَ, some of them when they were dying, like the Sahabas, Abu Hurairah and others, what did he say on his deathbed? غَدًا مَعَ مُحَمَّدْ. Tomorrow, you know, he's on his deathbed. So he said, tomorrow, I'm with Muhammad and my friends, Abu Bakr and Umar. Those are the people I'm going to be with. This whole life for them, it was there, on the other side. That's what it was for them. So the believer should live like that. بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. The reason Allah brought us to this world, brothers, is for us to work. Do deeds so we can enter Jannah. We've likened become what? We've forgotten the primary reason. And so what we made is that we live to eat. We live to enjoy ourselves. And this is not a characteristic of the believers. This is the characteristics of disbelievers. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Allah is talking about the disbelievers. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَأْكُلُونَ وَيَتَمَتَّعُونَ. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. The ones who are disbelievers, يَأْكُلُونَ, they eat and they enjoy themselves. كَمَا يَأْكُلُ الْأَنْعَامُ وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًا لَهُمْ. They eat and they enjoy themselves like the cattle and the animal, and the hellfire is what awaits them. The believer is not like that. Remember the reason why you are here. When you go work today and you sign in at 9 o'clock in the morning and you go to work, what is it that you're here for? Are you here to have tea? Are you here to socialize? Are you here to make friends? Or are you actually here to do a job? They hired you for a job. And you need to do that job that they hired you for. And if you don't, you get fired. صح? And then the same is with this dunya. You're here for a reason. That reason is for you to accumulate every opportunity around you. What ajr can I make? Because when death comes, you're going to be told, okay, bring out your actions. Where are your actions? Are we together, brothers? That's our primary reason. That is the ultimate, that's the ghaya, that's the hadaf that you're here for. No other reason. Everything else needs to work around that. Everything else needs to work around your obedience and your servitude to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Your job has to work around the salah. Your money around the deen. Around Allah and His obedience. Wallahi, that's the time it's going to be successful. Right now when people call and ask questions and they say, I have a job and I can't pray, what shall I do? That question should hurt you. The fact that you're asking should hurt the people's hearts. Why should it hurt? Because you're asking me, you are asking me, which one is primary? Your job or your ibadah? And the reason why many people have fallen into this is the fact that they make the deen revolve around their dunya. Isn't that the case? Those who go out, who pray all the salah at night time, dhuhr, maghrib, isha, fajr, all of it one time. All the salah one time, he'll pray it and he'll go work. What has he done? Wallahi, it's sad that if you had an interview, you would wake up and wallahi, 90% of the Muslims don't pray Salatul Fajr ala waqtiha. Sahih? Majority don't pray in the masajid and a lot of them don't pray the salah. Like in wallahi, you'll be on time for your work, you'll be on time for your university, you'll be in time for everything else. Like in the deen, now you realize, بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Now you ask yourself a question. If you're giving that importance to what? To a job, dirham and dinar, you're giving that value to it, then why do you think Allah should give you Jannah that is worth more than that? Because at the end of every month, what are you given? Are you given a salary, right? For the hard work that you exerted, that you came on time, that the company's going to give you your money for it, and the effort and the work that you did. So when you die, and you haven't worked properly, why do you think you deserve Jannah? Why do you think you deserve Jannah? It's a question you ask yourself. And Allah concluded the surah by saying, Inna hadha, this. This ismu ishara, which is hadha, the scholars of tafsir, they differed. And they disputed amongst themselves, what is it referring to? And there's three goals, three views. The first one is, it goes back to the whole surah. Innahu yarji'u ila suratu kulliha. It goes back to the whole surah, that the ayah, so this inna hadha this, meaning the whole surah. Another view is, it goes back to the ayah, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. It goes back to that. بَلْ تُؤْتِرُونَ حَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. It goes back to that segment. That's the second view. The third view is, it goes only back to ayah, وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. It goes only back to that. It goes back to only that. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari took the second view and he pushed that. It goes back to قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Allah says, إِنَّ هَذَا, indeed this, meaning either this, meaning the whole surah, or meaning قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى until وَأَبْقَى, or وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى, based on the third view, indeed this is in the former scriptures. It's in the former scriptures. All of this information that we studied, brothers, and all that which we took, it's in the previous scriptures as well. It's nothing new. Prophets have come with the same thing. So which scriptures? Allah tells us, Suhuf Ibrahim wa Musa, the scriptures of Ibrahim and Nabiullah Musa. And I will conclude there, inshallah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.